Lentipol. That is the, that's an annual fee for 2017, and those are the police policy and procedures, manuals of electronic system, and all of the municipalities that is, that are within our IMAC insurance group are being required to do this. We were ahead of the game and we signed up on our own a year or two ago. So this worked out fine for us. We were able to get a little bit of a discount even on our renewal. Moving on to another unusual item, would be going on page 6 of this packet to the capital project fund. And that's the replacement window systems, Inc. Those were the remodel that was done up here in the front of the city hall. So we finally got invoiced for that, so that's what that payment was for. Anybody have any questions on any of the bills that we're paying tonight? Okay, moving on. The next one is the collector's report. Again, that's the deposits other than taxes. Nothing real exciting within there. There were some building permit fees. There again, there was a little payment. When they do like pallet racks and other smaller improvements, I guess, to some of the existing buildings out at Ridgeport, they'll come in and have to get a permit for that. So other than that, the summer kind of slow month for building permits normally. So that's why that number is not. I mean, it exists. In other years, there was no money in there because there's just not a lot of projects that have things number. Other than that, it's pretty much status quo. Moving on to the December financial reports, we're probably going to just do line item transfers in March to readjust our expenditures, which would mean that it's just moving from one line to another line, not amending the budget. We should have, it's more or less taking the authority to spend from one line, putting it to the authority on another line where we need to incur expenses. So that would, my anticipated time to do that would be closer to the year end in March. So that way there we'll end the year in compliance where we need to be. Reviewing the overview of the funds. Again, the majority of the real estate, well, all of the real estate taxes have been paid by now. So December, January, February, March, we just, normally our expenses will exceed our revenues in those periods in general corporate, and that's due to the real estate tax dollars being already received prior to. So you'll see on the year-to-date balance, this is on page 8, the general corporate, at the start of December, our year-to-date balance was sitting on $5,000. And then it dropped down to 309. This is revenues over expenses. It's not cash. This is revenues over expenses. That's what we're looking at. So it's a profit loss situation, not a dollar in the bank account situation. So it's going as anticipated. Sewer capital project fund, that negative amount, that expense over the revenue is going to increase, and that's because we plan to do that. That's sewer capital project fund, that's an IEI study. So that number's not going to be positive because we're using fund balance, and that was a planned expenditure to occur over time. And the sewer operating fund, that number's negative because in December we paid that loan payment. So we'll start rebuilding that. That number will start going back upwards closer to the end of the year. The ESDA fund is showing a negative, so more, greater expenses over the revenues. And part of that is their funding diminished so much. In the past, we used to transfer $50,000 over there. This year, we're planning on moving $30,000 from general corporate. I've only moved a portion of that so far. So I'll be transferring some more money into there, just to, and it will make it appear better. They will end the year at about a break even. Other than that, that's the only real comments that I can make on this report. Anybody have any questions regarding any of the year-to-date financial information?
Does everybody understand the line item transfers that been talking about?
Yeah, we'll be doing those later. We did them last year. It seems to work well for us. Our department heads realize that they have to spend money for an unexpected expense. They try to identify a line that they're going to pull it from. So they'll forego doing this in order to accomplish that, to still stay within the budget authority. So So that's where we're at. And again, when we do our budgets, we're guesstimating actual expenditures, and some of those things that we're, I guess, estimating come in better and some worse. So, like this year, I know on all of our gas expense lines, we're going to have money left on those lines to reallocate to other lines, our vehicle gas, because gas prices stay low most of the year. So when we do our budget, we don't know. That's just an example of one line that we'll be able to move money from to another line that incurred more cost than we planned.
Any other questions for Kim? Okay, Kim, thank you for the report. Next item involves you too. Review and approve the purchase of a replacement vehicle for the Wilmington Police Department. Next one involves you too. Review and approve the contractual agreement between Mack and Associates and the auditing service for fiscal year end April 30th, 2017 in the amount of $17,900. What can you tell us about what you're getting for that money?
Well, Mack and Associates have been doing our audit. They rotate through with various partners so that there's a fresh set of eyes, really reviewing our records. This is a $400 increase over last year. And we didn't go out for an RFP this year. There again, part of my feeling on that is with change in a key position such as the city manager, I would like to keep somebody that knows what our books should be. Even though the city manager didn't maintain the books, I did, as the accountant. When there's a change in administration, I'd like to keep something consistent and the auditors know what our records should be. So coming into that, I feel better that I have somebody that kind of already knows what to look for. And additionally, I didn't have the time to put into due diligence to do an RFP and make sure that we were going to be getting the same kind of service. So I would want to make sure if we were going to do an RFP that we put that out there like June, July for the next year versus doing it at the last minute. So it's a $400 increase, which isn't bad at all in the auditing world.
We've had Mack & Associates for many years now, and they've always been very good, especially in the aspect, like you said, they continually have different eyes looking at them. So you don't get somebody that gets complacent and looking at the same numbers. You get different people every time.
Yeah, they added the CPA to their staff last year, and that person is my guess who will probably be the main person on it this year. Last year they were more of a grunt within the audit, learning more of the ins and outs. And in my opinion, as that person focused on one area, if that person becomes the main contact, they'll have a better understanding coming in. So, the government accounting standards constantly change as well. So. They're being educated, and we changed payroll systems this year, so they only really audited one quarter of that. I think it's because we've made some changes here. I think it's good to keep the continuity with them.
Does anybody have any further questions about the Mack and Associates contractual agreement? Can I get a motion to send the contractual agreement between Mack & Associates, PC, and the City of Wilmington to full council for approval?
I'll make it.
Second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you. All right, now, let's talk about review and approve the purchase of a replacement vehicle for the Wilmington Police Department through the lease program offered in the garage. What do you got, Chief?
Actually, Kim has the information. She got the lease.
Did you get the years?
I wasn't sure if you guys had seen the tentative lease agreement or not.
Is this going to be geared towards K-9?
This is for the replacement vehicle, administrative vehicle. K-9 is going to be the sergeant's vehicle that we talked about. That's why it's a little bit less than the vehicles usually are.
And this lease agreement was prepared with the understanding that payments would be made monthly. However, when I reviewed this today, I contacted Ford Credit, and we would be paying this lease on an annual basis versus monthly. So if we did it on an annual basis, we would be saving about $1,000 over the term of the lease by paying it annually versus monthly. And you know, there is no penalty for early repayment. So if we should find a windfall somewhere and want to pay off early, we could. But the first payment on this would be due upon delivery, and then annually for either 3 years or 4 years. The first, the 3 year lease, the first payment is due upon delivery, so there's 2 more years after that. So it's not delivery and then 3 more years.
So what is the annual payment?
Okay, so if we went with the three year, paying it annually, we would be paying $13,700 per year.
With the 3 year? Mm-hmm. Okay, because the number in here, okay, that's the top number.
Yeah, and so the actual cost of the vehicle plus the warranty and maintenance, and that warranty and maintenance is for the term of the lease. So in the past, as our discussions and actually as our practice has been, that warranty and maintenance pays for itself. So that right there, there's very little that would come out of pocket for warranty and maintenance on that vehicle. And that's been true experience with the other vehicles that we're leasing right now in the police department. So this is $38,820 that would be financed. The payment on an annual basis would be $13,700, doing it, in just an annual payment, versus $14,000 if we paid it monthly.
So be coming from the ME fund? Is that what the plan is?
Well, the initial payment can come from the ME fund. There's a balance of $12,200 in the ME fund now. So roughly about $1,500 shy. That would have to come out of operations right now. Because this really wasn't, when we talked about the canine unit, I don't think any of us really thought that it could come to fruition this quick within this fiscal year. So we would need about $1,500 out of the police department operating fund, and then use the $12,200 that's within.
Could we use the donations that have been coming in towards that difference? Is that what the plan is?
No, because this is not the canine vehicle. This is the vehicle to
replace
the chief's vehicle.
And what is the money that we get from the donations out? Where would that go?
That has to be used for the canine, but
right. That's for the, you have to buy the kennel for the officer's house, food, the veterinary costs that we're gonna, have because of this, all the other running things we have. We'll be getting a number tonight at 7:00 meeting from the coalition of how much they've collected for us.
And those donations would be ongoing then. This vehicle purchase is, if we were to buy a vehicle specifically for this, it would be much more. We would have to have different things.
No, I get what I guess what I'm trying to do is trying to give people a picture of what everything's going. You do have people that have contributed, and they want to make certain that the money that they put towards canine is going towards specific purposes and specific use for canine. And that's all I'm trying to get across.
Yeah.
What we're looking to do is we're looking to replace an admin vehicle, use the current vehicle that she said is the sergeant's vehicle to fit it with the donations we've gotten from the state's attorney to fit that vehicle with the canine equipment. This vehicle we're looking to place by is not, is it police package or just administrative only?
It is an administrative, so that's why it's less money.
That's why it's less money.
It's still a police package vehicle, but it's the administrative package. It doesn't have the computer mounts and all the other stuff that
not the bigger disc pads, the heavier duty batteries, all that stuff.
Right.
That has to go with it. So that's why it's less. That's not, what I'm trying to do is just try to get that out.
Yeah.
And that's how we get, that's
we're looking to expand from the B fund, the funds that we have, to purchase this new vehicle so we can move forward with the K9. And then it also, that the money that we raised is going to go specifically for, like you said, the purposes of maintaining that K9 dog throughout its life here.
Right.
At Wilmington for the officer, and like you said, the kennel and all that good stuff. So.
And you're going to have a fund that's going to be earmarked for that, correct?
Right now, there's a revenue line that's earmarked for the money that's been received thus far.
Mm-hmm.
And the revenue line itself is restricted to K9. So what will need to happen then at the end of the year, and the expenses that are coordinated with that, the revenue over the expense would then become a restricted fund balance or something, therefore, so carried into the next year.
For the budget, for like next year's budget, we've always got a line item for the MEP fund, mobile equipment fund, and it just continues to go that. It's got a designated purpose for the next 3 or 4 years, however we determine to go with the replacement vehicle. What portions of that MEP fund is going to go for the lease purchase of this?
The MEP fund can be used to purchase a vehicle. So what's the balance in there right now would be used to make the first year's payment of this. Now, that fund is not going to rebuild as quickly. You know, that what that was in there was probably 2 years worth, or potentially even 3 years worth of funds that we're accumulating. So that's going to take care of the first one. So as we move forward to make that lease vehicle payment, it's going to have to be paid for out of general corporate. We're going to have to budget for that lease payment. And it would just, it would be in the police department budget as a leased equipment expense. And that would have to be budgeted for. So that just comes out of their regular operating budget for future, the next 2 years.
We've kind of identified that money right now could come from all the money we're saving that's in the maintenance line item, you'll see, because we have these maintenance agreements with the leases, we're not spending that money on maintenance. So we thought that this money could be used in the future, in the next 2 years, to use.
What have we traditionally earmarked for the maintenance line item?
We just showed
$20,000 a year.
20?
Yes.
Yeah.
So we anticipate that could be significantly less because of the maintenance agreement. So we can channel that. Okay.
No. Chief, does this price include all of the bells and whistles, you know, the sirens and the lights and everything?
It has some lights, but it's not going to have all that stuff because it's an administrative vehicle. So it's going to have a very minimal package of.
Okay, I'm just asking because, you know.
Yeah, we shouldn't have to add on top of that. I think what you're trying to
yeah,
out,
I just want
to
know
how
much of an extra value.
Chief's going to drive this vehicle.
Yeah, let's see the chief's vehicle.
So there should be no
sometimes
additional.
Sometimes the chief's not around. Somebody else got to use the vehicle. They might have to go to a.
Yeah, that's why we got the lower price, so we didn't have the
okay.
Package.
All right,
so
just ask.
Now, the maintenance savings, they weigh against what you pay in the maintenance agreements, though, right? Are you taking that money that was budgeted for maintenance and using it as part of the lease payment to cover the maintenance portion of the lease?
We pay the maintenance agreement up front, and that's good for the 3 years.
Okay.
Then while we're leasing the vehicle, the maintenance and warranty. So that payment is built in.
It's a one-time
to the lease.
So there's no responsibility in that $20,000 to make any part of the current lease payments?
No.
Okay, that's my question. I didn't know if that was built in that way. Because
no.
That's actually what it's doing.
Can,
good.
Let's I'm just throwing this out there, Chief, maybe you can answer is, the K9 becomes operational, whatever it does, you know, could actually, there's funds that can be acquired through drug seizures, property seizures, and all that stuff. Can that money be earmarked towards the MEP fund, or does it have to be go on to a specific purpose?
It has to be used specifically for narcotics enforcement. That could be training, it could be equipment.
So it's a fine line there?
Okay. You have to be very careful.
Fund?
Yeah. Well,
That's
I think what needs to be thought of is, you know, as we know the life expectancies for canines, I think good is eight to nine years.
Yeah. Yeah.
It would be wise as we look at the future budget years if you create that line item for that specific purpose of anticipation of having to replace the can.
I don't like maintenance to a water treatment plant or anything else that we need to start doing properly.
Well, so, yeah, so you don't have these issues where you go without for so long.
How many vehicles do we currently pay for the city?
How many do we have leased?
I guess that we're responsible for, because aren't some of them part of Ridgeport?
Yeah, they're all part of Ridgeport right now.
This one too, or this would be?
No, this would be our.
This would be the only one the city is paying on.
Yeah.
Okay.
The city hasn't purchased a vehicle since 2013. It was the last one purchased, so everything from that point on has been Ridgeport vehicles.
Chief, the gift from the state's attorney, there's no hard dollar number on that, right? That just includes, it's going to include what we incur to acquire certain things, or is there a not to exceed on that, or what do we got?
We have a good estimate of that. Kim has it also. So what they're going to pay for is the canine itself. So the canine itself comes in a package with the dog, dogs being trained, leashes, dishes, bowls, some other things that are included with that minimal stuff. The training for the officer's housing while he's at training in Pennsylvania for the 4 to 5 weeks, 4 to 5, not 45. So it's all included. That's $11,000. The price of the container for the dog that goes in the vehicle and the other things that go with it, the equipment that makes the windows open automatically if the car gets too hot, heavy-duty fans to keep the dog cool, all that was it $4,000?
Yeah, that plus the installation of that equipment was about $6,500.
Yeah, so the equipment itself was $4,500 or $4,600. Installation was $2,500, so we included all that.
Were they able to open remotely? Did the officer have that ability to?
We're not going to do that because this dog is not a patrol dog. It's just a drug dog. So there's no need to pop him out like that. He won't be rescuing the handler.
I hope he doesn't have
to. Yeah.
So what was your green total of estimate of what we think we're going to give the state's attorney to help us with?
The ballpark was about 13.6.
13.6. I think it's 17.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, you're right. 17.6.
I don't remember. Did he throw a number at us? 45. Do you remember hearing something like that?
I remember hearing something
like that. Well, that's
what he said. What's
that mean? Okay. Possibility that.
Right. Turn towards the car.
That's what I thought.
Well, we're going to keep that separate though, so.
Yeah.
Right. But something else.
Okay.
Because there's going to be annual dog costs.
Absolutely.
I mean, we're estimating what those could be. And then there's going to be those annual dog costs for the food and for registration. As I'm learning, you have to, these dogs are, you have to have memberships when you have those dogs.
Okay. Now, the vet fees are free, right? I could have sworn one of the vets said they would donate.
I haven't heard that.
That'd be great. I heard through the wind. I know because our previous canine, Dr. Skinner, which Dr. Skinner isn't here anymore, he took care of that dog. I'm sure if we would love that, would be great. I think we'll be able to work on that.
Because that could be a huge variable cost. Because if the dog, you don't know what dog's
going to
need day
in, day out. Didn't you say that $25,000 that he was talking about that night, if it had to be allocated by a certain date?
No.
Yeah.
The state's attorney has been diligent in trying to get us to move forward as fast as possible. He wants to get that dog in play here. So obviously, he has his motives too, and trying to fight current also. So he's working hard to try to get us to move along. Every time I've seen the state's attorney, what are you guys doing? How are you going? How's it going? So the chief's been in contact with him.
I get a call on every week. So I think we can tell we're really close, huh?
Cool. Got a date. Training starts March 20th.
Nice. And I think that's key. We've all been concerned with that. But the most important thing is you need
be able to house it, and that's why we're here talking about the vehicle thing, to make sure that we have the ability to house the K-9 when it's done with the training as well as the officer. And where you don't need to be riding a bike all throughout town.
But you need. But the other thing is, because what I found out the other day is that Ford has been inundated with orders. Chicago Police Guard ordered, I think, 500 vehicles from Ford. Another big agency ordered a bunch of vehicles. It might take some time for this vehicle to come in. Roger was graciously said, don't worry, I will give you a car to use until that car comes in. But we still have enough in our fleet to use. So until we get one, we're not going to be shorthanded.
So you won't have to ride that bike?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got a motorcycle.
Yeah,
I think the motorcycle got that
motorcycle.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
There you go, give
me the thoughts. Okay, so Kip, are you confident now that we can make this happen?
Well, I am confident the first initial payment would be this budget out of the fund. Additionally, from there, due to cost savings and probably the other contributions that would come in on basis for the B fund could possibly be used towards that as well. But yeah, I think we would be okay.
Other than that, we'll be asked to come on with our budget.
Oh, yeah.
We'll have to be budgeted.
Yeah, we just have to be focused on the fact that, like you said, we're going to have, in the upcoming budgets, you're going to have to increase the budget quicker than we have in the past in regards to the B fund. But we can actually take that vehicle we're talking about and not have it in the B-fund, or us have it as a line item under the chief's budget, of the police operating budget.
That's
because
where the lease vehicles are now.
And that's what has to be done. Chief will have to continue to be diligent and trying to find ways to shave a few dollars here and there to make these kind of things happen. I know you do.
You do a great job, Ed.
So let's continue. So I'd like to make a motion to send. Are we doing this tonight?
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion to send the purchase replacement vehicle for the Wilmington Police Department through the lease program with Durazio to council for full council for.
And that we're doing that for 3 years, correct? Versus the four.
It's a 3 year plan.
It's not much difference to. I mean, you spend more in interest on the 4 years, you're better off doing the 3.
Okay. I agree.
So the option A then, correct?
Option A.
The option A, but it would be on a not on a monthly basis, right? It would be on an annual basis, so it would be a little less than.
Okay. You made the motion, I'll second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this? Anyone? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, we're off and running. Okay, let's review and approve resolution number 2017-02-8, resolution authorizing the participation in the Northern Illinois Municipal Electric Collaborative, NYMEC, and authorizing the interim city administrator to approve a contract with the lowest cost effective provider for a period of up to 36 months. What do you got?
This would be going out to bid. This is not the energy for the residents, but this really just affects the city operations and the water plant, wastewater treatment plant, street lights, trying to find the lowest possible energy cost for that. The NYMEC, which is a collaborative, has indicated they'll go out, we'll do the bid, bring the results back to us. Under the terms of the bid, we then have to sign off on that within 24 hours of that bid process taking place. And even with that sign-off, it still comes back to the council for formal ratification in your next regular meeting. When that, but this is simply to acknowledge, you know, receipt of that bid as it comes in, whether or not we go with a 12, 24, 36 month period. It's trying to find who that energy supplier is. You know, ComEd is simply just the conveyor of that energy. Yeah. Exelon could be one of the bidders, or who knows who those bidders are. So.
And we've dealt with NYMEC for many years. Yeah. I think what's always nice is, and Kim can attest, we get the NYMEC bid and then we always compare it to what the rate is of the charge we'll be in charge by ComEd. Sometimes it's pretty much just a wash to where there is not much significant or if any significant change at all. So we typically stick with ComEd for that upcoming year because that rate's locked in for a year, if I'm not mistaken, we go to ComEd. or really close, but doesn't very much.
It depends. The bids vary.
Yeah. Because we've been here, there's years we've gone with NYMEC, and then there's years we've stayed with ComEd, because NYMEC bid was not a significant difference than ComEd, and it wasn't for sometimes higher. I think the biggest challenge we face with anything with doing the NYMEC is the annually versus the 2-year and the 3-year, because once you bid on the 3-year, you're locked in for the 3 years. I know in the past, a lot of times we've typically stayed with the 12-month, because the way ComEd typically fluctuates with their
rate to go for 3 years. Mm-hmm. You know, you're open, the market doesn't.
It's a slight risk, not a huge risk. You're just basically high risk. I think it's getting more minimal risk now than anything else, because with ComEd and then the bigger push of the smart meter program, you're tending to see that rate continue to go up as they try to pay for that smart meter program that they're working on. It's a valuable source.
We're under no obligation to accept the price.
Yep.
But it gives us an opportunity to see what those competitive prices.
And I think what we're doing is giving Frank the authority to, once those NYMEC bids come in, to
sign up. Acknowledge them and then bring back.
And then that'll be a collaboration not only with Frank but with Kim and the rest of staff.
Right. So. Any other questions about it?
Does this cost the city any money to participate?
Not to my knowledge, no.
Isn't there sometimes a collaborative groups of communities that go in to try to negotiate a better price?
I think there had been on the residential.
Yeah, I don't know about this.
Yeah, I remember several years ago they had the push for residents to be a part of it, and it was on a ballot, it was a referendum ballot, and some municipalities voted for it, some didn't, because it was through the Will County Governmental. But even though it was a statewide, Will County governmentally kind of took it upon themselves as far as Will County goes. So there was the opt-in and the opt-out. Those who voted for it, you had the opportunity to opt-out. And
correctly, didn't the supplier opt-out after a couple of years on it?
They did opt-out, and there was a couple other suppliers that, you know, kind of filled that void. But anymore, I think, to me, that's why you see so many of these telemarketers anymore, like in our area with the opt-out program. You get all these energy companies that are trying to give the corner people and getting their rates. It's really become a competitive field, but it's become very challenging at the same time, because they try to lock people in for several years because that's what they want. They want that rate for a long period of time, not a short period of time.
Under the literature, NYMEC sent out, there are about 123 municipalities to participate in.
Yeah, no, NYMEC's got a lot. Any other questions? Can I get a motion to approve resolution 2017-02-A, resolution authorizing participation with the NYMEC program and send it to full council for approval?
I'll make it.
John, I'll make it.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Public comments.
Nope, I got Larry Jarvis.
She got it from screaming at the TV yesterday when the Cubs were at the White House.
Yep.
Didn't that
let it go.
She was hoping to see White Sox up there, but didn't.
At least I saw a W.
Okay, any further?
Not that side of town yet for a while.
Motion for adjournment?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
We've got a 25-minute break.
Wow.